everybody. Hey, I want to thank everyone who's on right now for the webinar tonight. We're really excited that you're with us. We're looking for a really blessed night of just being able to share on how we can help you as group leaders, help your teens get the most out of the Steubenville Conference. My name is John. I work in the Christian Outreach Office. I'd like to start us off with a prayer. It's always a good place to start. Let us begin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good and gracious God, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for everyone who is out there tonight, who's joined us on this webinar, who has stepped forward to be a part of a Steubenville Conference, who is out there to be a mentor and a guide in the faith for young people who are seeking Jesus. I ask, Lord, that you pour out through your Holy Spirit all the gifts that they need to be able to serve you well and to love these teens well and to guide them into your arms. We thank you for the Steubenville Conferences, what a gift they are to church, what a great gift it is to be a part of them on our end, and what a great gift it is for us to be able to serve so many awesome youth ministers and group leaders who come forward every summer to bring a deeper encounter with Jesus Christ to their teens. Bless, just bless this time. Use it to guide us closer to your heart and strengthen us as we guide teens in the same way. We just thank you, Lord, for your love during this Lenten season, that our hearts would return to you in a deeper way, that we'd have even a deeper outpouring of your Holy Spirit, and that all that we would do would be done for the glorification of your most holy name. And we ask this all in that holy name, Jesus. Amen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. Yeah, I just want to welcome everybody here. We are here in the Christian Outreach Office in three little separate office spaces tonight. Like I said, my name is John. I'm part of the team here in the Christian Outreach Office at Franciscan, and I am joined by two beautiful ladies who are part of the team as well. And actually, these ladies head up the programming for all of our conferences, and I'm going to ask them to introduce themselves. First, I'll ask Sarah to introduce herself. Go ahead, Sarah.
Thanks, John. So I'm Sarah. I'm the manager of youth programming, so I focus on our youth conferences and our Franciscan lead program.
I'm Kristi, and I'm the director of programming, and I primarily work with the adult and young adult conferences.
So anytime you have a question, all right, just go ahead and type it in there. It'll pop up on our screens. It'll get forwarded to us so that we can answer your questions. And as we go through this webinar, you know, we're just going to take turns presenting. If you have questions for a particular person or a particular topic, type it in right away, because after we're all kind of done summing up our sections, we'll take time to answer your questions. And at the end, if you have any other question that's not a part of the webinar topic that you want to throw out there, you'll have a chance to do that. And I'll also be asking you for ideas and suggestions for future webinars as well. But first and foremost, let me say thank you for being a part of this. We could not do what we do if you were not doing what you're doing. And thank you for laying down your lives and taking kids to the Steubenville Conferences. Our topic tonight is just how to help teens get the most out of the conference experience. And there's a lot of great ministers out there who've been doing this. I'm sure you guys have tons more great ideas, but this kind of comes from some of the feedback we've received and some of the ideas that we have in our office. We just want to kind of present on these, and once again, these are just some general guidelines of what I think you can do as a group leader, as a chaplain, to help your teens have an awesome conference experience. Now, I was a youth minister for about 15 years and took kids every summer to Steubenville conferences, and one of the first things I realized after my first conference, I should say, is that going into the conference weekend, you really need to, number one, have a plan. And what I mean by that is, you know, good ministry, it doesn't just happen. And the Steubenville Conference, as it exists, is like a supercharged weekend of grace that really gets young people on fire. But it is not the totality of Catholic youth ministry. It is not everything that youth ministry is supposed to be. And so it's always important to think about, if you're bringing teens and making this investment into the Steubenville Conference, how's that going to be a part of your overall plan for your youth for this year? What do you want to see happen? What would you like to see happen in your teens' lives while they're at the conference? And for that purpose, you should have a plan that's pre-conference. You should have a clear plan during the conference. And you should have a plan for what you're going to do post-conference. And what I mean by that is, you know, if youth ministry is, if the Steubenville Conference is an aspect of your current ministry, how are you going to incorporate preparation for the Steubenville Conference into those meetings and sessions? Should you have some unique experiences, some unique gatherings with the teams that are going to Steubenville in order to prep them? Is there certain things, you know, like, are you going to meet with the parents? Because oftentimes we hear young people come home having this radical encounter with Christ, and the parents feel left out of it. So how are you going to incorporate parents in some maybe the pre-conference prayer and planning? What are you going to ask the parents to do during the conference week in terms of praying for their teens? And it's always good to, you know, like what I used to do is I used to have parents sign up and do an hour of prayer. Every parent during the weekend would take an hour or two of prayer to pray for the kids so that throughout the entire weekend at any given time, there was somebody back at the parish, usually a parent, praying for the group. And then finally is, your kids leave the Steubenville conference excited, ready, open for more. And what are we going to do? What can you do to kind of harness that energy and harness that excitement and get them on a path of deeper growth and discipleship? And so this comprehensive plan isn't just like, okay, got to rent the bus, got to do this, got to that. You should have a plan for how you want to move from pre-conference through the conference and after the conference so that there's this seamless integration into your overall youth ministry program. Now, if you're in a place where maybe you're just a parent or somebody who's volunteering, maybe you don't have a regular youth group right now, I think one of the things that you might consider is using the Steubenville Conference experience as a way of building something that could really survive and sustain itself year-round. But once again, that involves a deeper plan. And we will touch upon some of these issues in further webinars. But first thing, you know, have a plan. Now, second, you know, you should have a mission. And what I mean by that is, you have to be asking yourselves questions like, what would I want to see happen in the lives of young people? Oftentimes, people bring young people, they put them in the room, and they just hope that by some magical, you know, experience, kids will come, their faith will come alive. But little things that you can do and as part of your mission can help make sure you're staying focused on that. I see youth groups at Steubenville conferences, and they don't take advantage of the small group time. You know, maybe they decided that, hey, we've done enough. We don't let our kids kind of roam. I see other groups sitting around that are very intently focused. And if you want, if one of your goals is, I want to build community within my youth group. I want to see a stronger community within my youth group. You know, then you definitely want to have it as part of your mission to make sure that you're forming that community throughout the conference weekend, that you have kind of a plan to make sure that you take advantage of every moment of the conference. Because if you come in and just say, well, we just want to have a good time, I guarantee you the kids will have a good time. Kids have a great time all the time at Steubenville conferences. But with a little bit of effort through your planning and through having a mission focus, can mean it's not just a great weekend, but a transformative experience where they're really engaged and ready to go deeper in the relationship with Christ. You know, and you should have a mission. What would you like to see in the lives of individual youth? Because your youth and your youth group are in different places. So know your youth and say, okay, what would I like to see happen in this young person's life? Maybe they just need to come to know the deeper love of Christ. So, you know, you really might focus on relational ministry with them throughout the weekend, or have one of the chaperones take special care of walking with them on that spiritual journey. You might have some kids who've been to two or three student conferences, or, you know, just through the ministry you're doing, they're real leaders. Well, I think you'd want to try to activate that sense of leadership that they have and help them maybe even co-lead small groups on the weekend or share their testimony on the bus on the way there. Do something to help stir the faith and give them a role in the ministry, because some of them are ready to take on that challenge. But if you have, you know, if you have a mission that kind of takes into account where the different young people in your group are and engage them accordingly, then you know what happens from the stage and in the main sessions and in the breakouts, all that will mean that much more to them, because it's really, there's more to what you're doing than just saying, okay, sit there the way you sat there last year. You know, maybe they're ready to do more, take on a deeper leader role. If you're going to have a mission, you're going to have a plan. You know, it's going to be very important that you communicate it with everyone that you're bringing as a chaperone. Some of you on this webinar tonight are group leaders. You're in charge of organizing and pastoring the group, and you've stepped forward to be the leader. Some of you might be chaperones, but if you don't communicate to everyone involved, this is why we do what we do, and this is what we're trying to help see happen in the lives of young people, then the group leaders won't understand their role. The chaperones won't know exactly what's expected of them or what they should be doing in certain circumstances to help this young person on their spiritual journey. So it's about knowing what you want to see happen. It's about having the ability to articulate that to everybody in your group and let them know what their role in that is, so that as a team of chaperones and group leaders, you're working to accomplish the goals that you set forth, to execute the plan that you have, which is not just to give kids a great weekend, but to really get them deeper in a relationship with Christ and deeper in the community that you're building through your youth ministry program. And, you know, once again, you know, the most important part is, you know, just pray for that plan and mission and ask God to show you what you need to do. A lot of you are in different circumstances. You may be in a small parish where you have 10 kids that you're bringing. You might be part of a group that's bringing 50 or more. But whatever your group size, whatever your goals are, whatever the needs of your parish are, think about how you can make sure that you're addressing those throughout the conference weekend so that young people have just a beautiful experience that isn't just, like I said, a great weekend, but a lasting, lifelong, changing experience with the Lord. That's basically, you know, the first 2 points. And that's, you know, if there's any questions at this point, feel free to type them in. Somebody just typed in and said, by youth group, let's see here. Okay, I'll make that bigger. Yeah. Do you mean youth ministry that happens in the parish or about the group of youth who will be attending the student youth conference? If you're, okay, so maybe this question, maybe you can clarify for me, Marie. Are you coming as part of a diocesan group where you're one parish that's part of a bigger group? Or, you know, are you talking about the fact that maybe you do combined parishes? That would help me understand, but, you know, I would actually say, even if you're a smaller ministry that's being attached to a larger group for the weekend, I think, you know, the plan needs to be customized, I guess is the word, customized to the group that you're bringing from your church, you know, and to the best of your ability, make sure that what you see your parish needs is not being not addressed throughout the conference weekend. So, if I understand your question, so by youth group, do you mean the way gather youth ministry happens in the parish, or about the group of youth that will be attending the Steubenville Youth Conference? You know, it is really for the parish, the smaller group, even if it's part of a bigger group that's coming from a diocese or a group of parishes. I hope that helps. If that didn't answer your question, feel free to ask a clarifying question. All righty. And like I said, anytime a question pops up, you can put it in type it into the question box. That's part of the toolbar. If you see the little arrow, click on it, it'll open up the box. It'll drop down if the arrow's pointing to the right. And then you'll see the place where you can type in the questions. But for now, I'm going to turn it over to Kristi, who is going to talk about some other important aspects of the conference experience. Take it away, Kristi.
Great. Thanks, John. So my first point is to talk about having guidelines. Anytime you have a group of people together, you're going to want to have guidelines to make sure that everyone moves and grooves together and that everything operates well. So these guidelines are sometimes just for the physical well-being of your group, and then sometimes it's for the spiritual well-being of your group. So kind of keep both those things in mind. And make sure that you're communicating why the guidelines are in place. So why do we need these things? So make sure that everyone knows what the goal and the purpose of the guidelines are, which are to create a safe place for everyone, as well as to create a place that we can be vulnerable with the Lord. These guidelines can be unique to your group. I'm giving you some suggestions, but it's important that they're unique to what you know that you need. You may talk to somebody who's been to a Steubenville conference before and kind of think through, okay, what are some other guidelines that they've needed? But I'll give you some suggestions here at the end. The other thing would be you really need to make sure that there is a policy to enforce these guidelines, because a guideline that can't be enforced really isn't a policy, or isn't something that you can, if you can't enforce it, then it's not really, there's no point in having it, right? So everyone needs to know about the guidelines. Everyone needs to all the chaperones need to have the ability to enforce them. All the chaperones need to be on the same page that they're going to enforce them. So, for example, if one of your guidelines is no negative humor, that's a really easy one for even chaperones and group leaders to slip into, even myself. You know, we know those people, they just have negative humor. And so if you know that you as a chaperone, or you know that some of your chaperones have negative humor, we need to make sure that everyone's on the same page, that we're all going to hold each other accountable to this. And so make sure that there's a way in which you're holding them accountable. One silly example that we've done in a little bit of a group, kind of youth group setting, is we had a scripture verse that anytime somebody said something that was negative, we just reminded them of that scripture verse very gently. And then if it came up again, then we'd do it again. And obviously, you know, at some point you have to kind of say, okay, if they're more serious, like, you can't just keep doing it the second time again. But that's just one idea of how you can, like, enforce it and have gentle reminders. And, you know, obviously the adults and the chaperones need to hold to the policies as well. So when it's something like that, that way the teens can actually take part in holding you accountable as well. Good for them to see that, you know, you can mess up, but you're going to get better. So it needs to be specific, too. Your guidelines can't be just stay out of trouble or, you know, be a good Christian group. Like, a lot of times it's the teaching moment where we're teaching them, like, okay, what does it mean to be together and to move in a group? So, perfect example with a negative humor. It's really nice to teach them about how negativity can tear us down. If that's one of your guidelines, then throughout the weekend, that's something that they'll learn. One idea is to come up with a creative and fun way to communicate these to the group. This would be something you'd want to do prior to the actual conference itself, or like the day that you leave, you can communicate it to them. But come up with a fun way to do it. Have all of your chaperones help out. Maybe everybody can share a personal testimony, or like not a serious testimony, but, you know, like a personal story of why this guideline is important. You know, if it's something as simple as a guy stay in guys' areas and girls stay in girls' areas. Well, somebody can tell a story of time when that didn't happen and it didn't go well. Obviously, keep it clean. But there's just ways in which you can tell these, make these creative. You can do them in just different creative ways. So think about that. Think about ways that you can do that. Some other examples of some guidelines: no judging, no putting each other down, kind of goes with negative humor. What a person shares stays private. Don't talk about it with another person. So even if, like, say this whole small group, we share, somebody shares something, nobody else in that small group should share about it with them. They should talk about it later, even though they were all in the small group and heard the thing. So what's shared stays private. Obviously, respecting authority in each other and the facilities that you're going to, if you're staying in a hotel or a dorm. Some of those basic, again, kind of keep them in two categories, like, what's going to be the things that are going to keep them safe and keep the stuff around them safe? And then what are some things that are going to make them able to be more open to the Lord? So that whole, like, not sharing personal things with other people, letting people feel safe to be able to share their hearts, building each other up, no negative humor, an attitude of service, taking care of your body. Some of these conferences are really hot. Amazing to think that right now is it's super snowy outside. But it's true, like, some of the conferences is super hot, and so drinking water, making sure everyone's eating. That's also, just as a side note, it's nice to have that guideline that everyone has to eat every meal. So that if you do have anybody there that's struggling with an eating disorder, you can easily hold everyone accountable. So it makes it easier to hold people accountable if they do struggle with an eating disorder, if it's just clear that everyone has to eat every meal. And again, drinking lots of water and stuff like that. So those are just some of the examples. Again, you're going to want to make these guidelines unique to your group and what you know is needed. If you've never been to a Steubenville conference before, again, it's good to talk to somebody who has to come up with some ideas. A lot of these will probably carry over from some guidelines that you might have from a retreat or some other gathering that you've done. So, any questions about that? Let's see. Okay. I don't think so. Okay, so let's go on to the next point, but if you have questions, you can type them in. The next one I have is creating community. So this is something that we just want to be super intentional about, creating community within your group. It does take a little bit of effort so that everyone's not just individuals traveling together and experiencing something together, but it's actually a community experience. Evangelization, true evangelization, takes place in community. Jesus taught us that time and time and time again. So one of the ways that we do that throughout the conference weekend is that we really encourage small groups. We say from the stage, teens, make sure you go to small groups. Make sure you're sharing in small groups. And we talk about the value of small groups. So obviously you're going to have small groups on the conference weekend, but start those earlier. So maybe 3 months out from the conference, 2 months out, whenever you start gathering people, go ahead and pre-assign them to the small groups and start having them meet in small groups so that they can start to get to know each other in their small groups. They can start to share their expectations, their thoughts. Now, obviously, you may not get everyone together, but try to get as many as you can together and do what you can with the people who do show up. Another idea would be to assign prayer partners. So I think John mentioned this, that he had done this in the past, but assigning prayer partners. This is prior to the conference that they would be praying for each other. But then actually at the conference, they can also get together and pray together at the conference, and then also continue on afterwards. So it's a great before, during, and after experience, and it also, again, creates community. What you can do is have, you know, the small groups. We encourage same-gender small groups, and then have, within your small groups, have the prayer partners as people within the small groups. So you're even going kind of like a level deeper within your small group. The whole point of this is that they are getting comfortable with each other and learning how to be more vulnerable with each other. When you're in small groups, a great way to create that comfortability and vulnerability is to really pray together, teaching them communal prayer. Some of you are already probably stars at this and doing this in your youth groups really well, but if you're not, this is a great opportunity to learn and teach them how to pray together and pray out loud. Sometimes they really need structure to it, so you can say, okay, we're going to go around the circle and everyone's going to share one prayer intention that they have for someone else and one prayer intention that they have for themselves. Because sometimes teens can get really wrapped up in praying for other people and they don't focus on what God's doing in their own heart. So that's a good way to like get them, okay, we're going to say one prayer intention out loud for yourself and one prayer intention for someone else. And actually have them say it as if they're praying it to the Lord. So don't just say, I want to pray for my mom, but more of, well, I'm not saying like, I'd like my prayer intention to be for my mom, but more say, teach them how to say it to the Lord. Like, God, I ask that you would bless my mom for this reason and such and such. They really need that invitation to do this. Oftentimes, they just need a little invitation and a little bit of teaching and structure, just to really get out of themselves and get a little uncomfortable, but for the sake of something good. Another place that's a great way to create community is really anytime you gather, and we know that a lot of times that time of gathering is fundraising. And so when you do a fundraising event, those can be great community building events as well. Sometimes they're more community building events than they are raising money, which is awesome, and that's okay too. That's valuable and a great, great thing that's going to build up your group. So use those events that you already have scheduled to keep in mind community. if you have maybe an info meeting night, do a little community building as a part of the night. So don't just have it be all information, but do some community building at that as well. And this all is about really getting their hearts and their minds ready. As the stuff that you're doing in building community before the conference is getting their hearts and their minds ready and tilling the soil for what's going to go on in their hearts. And so the next topic is Sarah's going to touch, and it's specifically about tilling the soil. So this idea of these are kind of the practicals that I've mentioned, and she's going to go into the more in-depth things. Just if there are any questions, it looks like how many kids are in a small group? I say no more than 10, but I say the sweet spot, I don't know, John, you can tell me what you think about this, but I think a sweet spot is 6 to 8. Do you agree?
Yeah. You know, we have most of our conference sites have a rule where you have to have one chaperone for every 10 young people. So that's going to be the maximum ratio. But with that, it's always more difficult to manage a conversation amongst 10 people than it is, you know, like Kristi was saying, 6 to 8 would, you know, I mean, 8 would be the most that I'd want, only because I'd want to be able to give everyone a chance to share and give them the personal attention. The great challenge, of course, when you're coming to a student conference is how do you find enough adults to have a 6-to-1 ratio? If you can't do that, it's not going to ruin the event, but if you can, I highly recommend it, only because the more personal attention that you're able to give within small group to each person, the more chances to share, the more enriching it will be for everyone involved.
Yeah, 6 to 8 seems to be a sweet spot. 10, it does seem hard to manage. So, but you know, I wouldn't go over 10 if at all possible. I sometimes see groups at the Steubenville conferences, and it's like a huge, large group. I really just, my personal opinion is to discourage that because people get lost in those big groups. And everyone may want to share, but there's a time and a place for that. That's not a small group. That's sharing, you know, big sharing. So what kind of community, another question, what kind of community building would you do during the info meeting night? I'll share a couple of ideas that I have, and then maybe John and Sarah can share any that they would have as well. I know Sarah was going to touch on this too, but, you know, one way of building community is obviously getting vulnerable with each other. So when people know my story and they know more about what, you know, where I'm coming from, then that creates a connection. So if I were to sit here and tell you a little bit about my life, then you would be more connected to me and we would have a little bit deeper community. So anytime you can give opportunities for that. So have them all split up into a group and share why they want to come on a Steubenville conference. And be honest, like it's just that they were made to go or if they, you know, whatever that would be. Maybe somebody else sharing a testimony about their experience at a conference. Somebody sharing a testimony and then having, you know, go to the person next to them and share, like, what struck you about that testimony. Getting them to talk really is helpful in those types of things. And again, on a meeting info night, it can be simple, it can be short, it can be, you know, again, at the beginning, turn to the person next to you and tell them why you're coming on Steubenville conference. Another thing could just be, you know, have them split them into groups of three and just have four get to know you questions with each other. So those are a couple ideas that I have. Anybody else have any ideas on what they could do at an info meeting night to create community?
I think everything you suggested is great. Just another, just even smaller ideas, just to play some fun icebreaker games. There's a lot of good resources online. Just give them an opportunity to be goofy and have fun. And a lot of times that breaks down those walls to enable those conversations that Kristi was talking about in small groups. So just something that lets them be themselves and goofy. And they might be hesitant at first, but by the end, they all seem to really enjoy it.
Yeah, I think those suggestions are great. The idea of fun, I think it was Plato said you can learn more about somebody in 5 minutes of playing than you can in 5 hours of conversation, because you just, it's just, there's something about fun that reveals what's going on in people's lives in a deeper way and does break down barriers. So you definitely want to have a fun icebreaker. You know, when you do an info meeting, there's two different kinds. There's one where you maybe you're prepping the teams, but we always had at least one, if not two, where we brought the parents in. And the idea that, you know, we are been entrusted to take their teens, their children away for the weekend to encounter the Lord, we don't want to leave them behind. You know, we don't want to make them feel left out. So some ideas that we've tried in the past is we had some of the adults that we knew who had active faith lives get up and share their testimony with everybody, you know, so that they can see that their parents had this personal encounter with Christ and what it meant to them. We had teens from past summers share their testimony like Kristi suggested. And then, you know, I mean, a great way of building that community, too, is to do some sort of communal prayer experience as part of it. So you have a little bit of fun. Go through your guidelines. And we always do the guidelines with the parents present, because we wanted the parents to understand that we were going to take care of their kids, that we weren't just going to throw them on a bus and it was going to be chaos. And when you have those guidelines and you present them to both the teens and the parents, and you hand a copy to the parents and say, please review these with your teens later, it just makes it all the more real, and it brings the parents into the process of knowing, oh, my there are expectations. And, you know, just a personal story about guidelines, you know, we've had We've always used the Steubenville Conference experience as a way of bringing kids who are kind of on the fringes or not involved in youth group into the process. And that's a great challenge, because when you have a youth group that's kind of focused and has a culture, maybe throughout the year you've been building up a level of trust, and then all of a sudden for something really significant you have a few wild cards in there. And also this comes from a conversation I just had a couple weeks ago with a youth group who said, I'd like to bring more kids, I just can't control them. You know, and then I started talking about, like, okay, this is how you can help that process. You know, there was an incident where one of the kids who was new kind of really shut down a small group by some inappropriate comments. And they were really outside the guidelines. So, you know, we had to sit down and reestablish trust and walk through this young person. But they had a great growing experience. They realized maybe for the first time in their life that the power of their words. And even though there was, I would say, minor collateral damage because of that, it all got resolved throughout the conference weekend, and this young man became a regular attendee of our youth group because he experienced love and forgiveness. But to hold people accountable is a good thing, to have them clearly stated, like Kristi said, is an absolute must. And to bring parents into that process, I just think it makes it easier for you. So, you know, all the ideas for those meetings definitely are great ideas and things that you should be working on.
Another question that's up here is, how do we involve the youth who have not registered but come to regular meetings without making them feel left out of the experience? So I think what you're trying to say is that you often will do some of this with, like, your entire youth group, and it's not people that are registered as well. is what I'm understanding that as. One suggestion would be maybe just to have, make sure that it's only people that are registered. There's a difference between like an info meeting night where it's like, hey, come and find out more about this and to get people excited about coming versus kind of a more, hey, this is for the, all those who are registered. So I think knowing, you know, having specific targeted meeting sessions is a good idea so that you're not making people feel left out and you're saying, hey, some people here, you know, this is more specifically a recruiting, for lack of a better word, meeting. Or this is more of an actual time where we're digging in and this is specifically for people who are already registered. Would you agree with that, John? Any additional thoughts on that one?
Yeah, you know, Matt, when I read the question, I was thinking, like, what if you have a kid who's a regular member of your youth group and he can't go to Steubenville, he doesn't register. Everyone goes off and has this wonderful experience in May, and they all come back on fire, and this kid's like, oh, I missed out on it. And I think part of that, you know, this is why, you know, if you set up the Steubenville conference experience to be part of that comprehensive experience, then what happens at Steubenville, you can use that to build that kind of community for the young person. And I've dealt with this. I've dealt with kids who've been heartbroken to the point of tears because, the year that they want to go to Steubenville, either have a camp or a wedding or, you know, some sort of tragedy that they have to cancel. And, you know, it's just up to your youth group to really make sure that, and I think this is part of your plan, is to say, coming out of the summer, we're not going to be a clique of, we're the Steubenville kids of the youth group. We're the ones who had this, and everyone else who didn't get to go to Steubenville, so, you know, too bad for you. But really giving them that challenge to, you need to share what God has done with somebody who hasn't come, and pray with them, and pray that they experience the same thing that you experienced. That's your challenge. And that way, people aren't holding on to it like, oh, this is so wonderful for me. But really, they're bringing other people into that encounter by sharing that love and, you know, helping them, you know, not feel left out of the because they weren't part of the Steubenville group that went. And there's going to be some other things. We can talk about this. We're going to have a whole other webinar of, you know, some good ideas to work with your teams coming out of the conference that I think will really help with that as well.
Hey, John, do we want to do the next question or do we want to go on and we'll come back to them at the end?
You know what? Just real quick, there's somebody typed in and said, I'm a new youth minister. Do you recommend any certain type of small group icebreaker questions? And Katie, we have your email from a registration, and I will make a note to myself to email you a PDF with what I consider the best small group questions ever written, and I did not write them, but they're awesome. So I will, and there's different, like, get to know you questions, going deeper questions, how, you know, some questions that start the process of being vulnerable, and then some heavy hitters that really help break open the gospel message. In addition, you'll receive when you go to the conference some questions that are put together by Sarah and her team that really nail unpacking the talks and stuff that you're going to hear at the conference as well, Katie. So we're going to have, I'll give you some general tips, and then you'll also be receiving some very specific questions that will help throughout the conference weekend. And now everybody wants the PDF. Okay, I will do a general email blast to everyone. I'll be sitting on that computer. Thank God for cut and paste. All right. Think. Yeah, just for the sake of time, everyone, you get a list of questions. You get a list of questions. Everybody gets a list of questions. That's my Oprah moment. All right, so with that, we're going to pass it off to Sarah, and we're going to enter into the next part of the presentation. Sarah, take it away.
Great. And so I'm going to be talking about, like Kristi mentioned, how to till the soil, how to really prepare their hearts for what God wants to do on the conference weekend. And as Kristi alluded to, that community building is key. It's the foundation for trust and relationships so that they will be encouraged by you. They'll be open to new experiences. They'll be willing to share what's on their heart with you and with their fellow teens going with them on the conference. So that is a huge foundation. And you can do this collectively as a group in some of your meetings when you come together, but also in that small group and individual setting that John and Kristi have been talking about. And so collectively, I think it's great to start by just acknowledging that everyone here is in a different place with the Lord and really giving them freedom and permission to be where they are, and that God's going to encounter them and meet them where they are. And God's love being the foundation, that's the driving force of all of our conference programming. In the midst of the schedule, in the midst of everything that we do in the conference weekend, the basic foundation is we want the teens to know God's love for them. So if they're already hearing this, I feel like we can't hear that enough. I can't hear that enough. I'm constantly coming back to that and what that means for me in my life. And so I'm giving them permission to be where they are. I'm really just emphasizing God wants to meet you. God loves you and has a plan for you. I'm really setting the stage for them. And our hosts do a great job of this on Friday night of our conferences, but them hearing it already before the conference would be a huge benefit to them. And as I was preparing, I was thinking some teens might not even know where they are in their relationship with God because they've never thought about it or never have taken the time to. So I think it's important to really have an environment of prayer, some time in silence, perhaps having them journal or write a letter, just really pinpointing and thinking about where they are with the Lord. How might he be calling them to change? What change do they want to see in their life? How might he already be tugging? Asking them some questions to get them to think. They're so busy running from one thing to the next, maybe not having time to process past encounters they've had in youth group or what God might be speaking to them because they just haven't had the time to sit and listen. So I think that's important to really have them pinpoint where they are, and just acknowledging that where they are is a good place to be. Another thing you can do is start to introduce the theme of the conference. Many of you may know our theme is thirst, and our scripture is Romans 5:8. But God proves his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So introducing that theme to them, and again, it comes back to the foundation. We want them to encounter Christ's thirst for them, especially focusing on the cross and his sacrifice for us, and returning God's thirst by thirsting for him, and really realizing that he is the only thing that will really satisfy. So just starting to scratch the surface with that theme might be a huge benefit to them in preparing their hearts for the weekend. And then on the small group basis, to really empower your small group leaders and your chaperones to, as Kristi mentioned, get to know their teens and to find out where they individually are. Because when you know where they are in the journey, you're really able to prepare them well. So you would speak very differently with a teen who maybe is only coming because a friend invited them or is doubting that God is even real, to maybe a teen who's been to several conferences or has gone on many retreats and already has that relationship with Christ and wants to go deeper. So it's really important to empower your small group leaders to get to know where their group is. And so through intentional questions, creating an environment where they can have one-on-one conversations, maybe if you have an opportunity for a couple community events, you know, as it gets closer to the conference, having small group leaders try and have some one-on-one conversations with them. Again, getting to know where they are to prepare how to minister to them on the weekend. And then lastly, having teens minister to one another. John alluded to this as well. Just having, maybe if you've taken a group to a conference before, having them share about their experience, or even if you haven't, if there are some teens that are just solid and are on the journey with Christ, just to share about it. Peers are so receptive to peer witness. So just to share and create excitement and enthusiasm how God could be working in their life by witnessing their experience. So great. And so I'll take a moment, pause, and look at the questions, see if there's any, if you have any questions about that, you can type them in. Okay, I don't think I see any. Okay, great. So, and then the next piece to that is just, you know, fertilizing the soil. How can you already give them opportunities to encounter Christ before the weekend? And so, a lot of the things I'm going to mention are things you probably already do, but perhaps maybe you can do it just as a group going to the conference. And also a lot of these things are aspects of our schedule. So especially for teens that have never come, you can start to give them a little taste of what they'll experience on the weekend. So for example, going to Mass as a group, perhaps having a time of Eucharistic adoration together, telling them what that means and that Jesus is truly present in the Eucharist. Perhaps having time of worship. Worship is a huge component of our conference, is an opportunity for them to start to understand what it means to praise and have them exposed to praise and worship. Confession, if any teens are open to go before the weekend, obviously confession is a huge part of our weekend. So many teens go and it's beautiful, but if they're open to going ahead of time, that their heart might be even more well-disposed for what God wants to do on the weekend. Even practically, if you've gone, you know, the lines can be pretty long. So if there's teens that maybe you have a desire to go early, that might be a great opportunity for them as well. As well as just getting some prayer support from the community. John mentioned getting the parents involved, perhaps doing one of these things with the parents there. Another idea is to just have the parish interceding, maybe having parishioners draw names of the teens that are going and letting them know people are praying for them. So just see how important this experience is and just how people love them and are supporting them and want to see them grow in their relationship with Christ. And kind of the final point, just as an overarching thing I wanted to mention is, in all this preparation and sharing about experience and being open to God's encounter, is to not push emotions, to allow them to expect God to work, to know that God is going to be there and show up, but it's not always about emotions and feelings. A lot of teens will measure their encounter with God or how much God loves them or was with them by the emotions they might feel on the weekend, or they might look around and see a teen, you know, being touched by the Lord and crying or something like that, and think, well, what's wrong that I'm not experiencing that? So just as it was good in the beginning to affirm you're all in different places, it's really important to say God is going to work in the way he wants to work in you personally, and to not be focused on how God is working in everyone around you, but to really have that expectation that God's going to show up, but not in the specific way in which he's going to work, particularly with feelings and emotions, so it doesn't hinder their experience and they're just open to however God wants to speak to them on the weekend. And then overall, just framing the trip as a pilgrimage, a weekend away to really encounter the Lord, and of course, an opportunity for community and fun, really an opportunity to step out of their everyday life and to see what God has in store for them. So that, I know, John, I would mention too, and in your plan, just having, how are we going to keep this fire burning? And so I know we'll see if we have questions, but John is going to share a little bit more about how we're going to try and help you do that as well.
Yeah, we're going to, this is the first of monthly webinars that we're going to have for youth ministers and group leaders, and they're going to be different topics. So I just sent a link to everybody, or I chatted a link to a Box account that if you click on the link right now, I said, my first message was, hey, everyone, here's the link where you can download a Word doc of my favorite smartphone questions, and then I sent the next one, it had the link in it. Has anyone I don't know, did everyone receive that link and can try clicking on it to make sure they can get that file? If you would just chat that questions. If there's anyone who's tried the link and can't get through, let me know. Because right now, everyone on the, it's there right now. You just click in your chat box on that link. It'll download, it'll open it up in our Box account, and then you just hit download and you'll have it on your hard drive on your computer. And I'm just assuming because you got on here that you were able to, you'll be able to do that. So it's not that technologically challenging. It's interesting having served on both sides of the conference stage. You know, I sat in the audience with teens for many years, praying anxiously that they would have this encounter with Christ, being in great admiration of how wonderfully the conferences were run, and then and not only just with, sometimes with terror, like, what am I going to do with these kids after I get back from conferences? And how can I help them through? You know, like, what are they experiencing? How can I help them? It's very challenging, you know. And but I think part of it is just knowing what you want to see happen, and all the suggestions that Sarah and Kristi shared are just really. It's kind of youth ministry 101, but sometimes I think we have a tendency to overcomplicate, the way we do ministry. You know, our job here in the office is simply to create that space where kids can encounter Christ. The much harder job is on your shoulders, which is to walk with teens after the conference experience is over and be able to share the love of Jesus and help them after they've come down off the mountain and the feelings wear off. You know, part of that is helping them up the mountain, you know, and understanding what they're going to experience when they get there and tilling that soil so that, you know, they, if some kids don't know how to get up the mountain, they might not know how to get up to the top. So part of it is getting those kids to the top where they can have that really deep encounter with Christ, like the transfiguration type experience. But then also having that plan to walk down with them. So having the plan is important. have the mission, have those guidelines. They're absolutely like imagine playing pickup basketball. We used to do this a lot at this old elementary school about half a mile from my home. And the games would turn into a brawl every time because it would be like, you follow me. No, I didn't. And we'd start punching each other, you know. And without rules, everything breaks down really quickly. And the whole process of what you're trying to build with love and community, I can't emphasize enough. The guidelines are essential. The creating the community is a great idea. You know, it's just key to everything that you're trying to do as youth ministers, because while we all love the fact that we can have a personal relationship with Christ, it's best experienced within community. And it's best experienced when it's shared with other people in community. And that's something that we as adults don't even know how to do well, to share our faith with one another. And so it's even more difficult, I think, sometimes to teach young people how to do that. But you can model it for them. That's the great thing about being and prepping for it. You can model vulnerability. You can have your chaperones model what giving testimony about God is. You can have them model spontaneous prayer. You can have them model how to really affirm someone when they share something well. You know, these are skills that are more taught by example than taught through a lesson. You know, like do 1, 2, and 3, and you'll have the perfect small group. You know, and so you have a chance prior to the conference to model what you're trying to create and see happen during the conference weekend. Tilling the soil, absolutely essential. You know, we see kids come from all across the gamut. Some kids who are like really into their faith, some people who are far away from God. The miracles that we see are young people who, and then we get this thousands of times, I went into that Steubenville conference Saturday night, did not believe in God. I don't know what happened, but I know that God loves me and he's real. And they're like on fire. They're crying. You know, what Sarah said is key. We don't want to push the emotions. You know, we don't want to tell kids, oh, when you go in there, you're just going to emotionally vomit all over everybody. You're just going to, like, fly everywhere, and you're going to be crying. And, like, no, just tell them you're going to encounter Christ and ask them just to be present to Christ and open their hearts. If he leads them to tears, he will do that. But we should not be pushing young people to tears, because if it's not coming from the Lord, if it's not a reaction to what God is doing, then it could be a hindrance to the real Spirit moving. So letting kids know that in advance. I mean, I still remember a few years ago walking into a Saturday night event. I was there helping to run some things behind the scenes, and I heard a youth minister say exactly, oh, when you walk in there, you're just going to cry like crazy. You're just going to experience God like, and you're going to cry and cry and cry. And I'm like, what if they don't? And they're going to walk away thinking, I didn't experience God. You know, so we don't want to, kind of set them up for disappointment. You know, but fertilizing that soil, I probably shouldn't talk too much, but my wife taught me how to be a gardener. I was never a gardener. My wife taught me how to be a gardener. And the first thing I learned was, in order to make things grow, sometimes you have to amend the soil. You got to fertilize. You got to stir things up. You got to prep before you can expect fruit to be produced. And so my job in gardening was to do that, to haul the manure, to dig, to do all the heavy lifting, and then she'd get to dig little holes and plant seeds or plant little plants and see all the beautiful things happen. But I did all the dirty work, which I didn't mind doing because it was necessary. Every spring we'd have to amend the soil and till the soil where our garden is if we want things to grow. And that's absolutely essential. The more you till the soil and fertilize and get these kids ready, the greater the fruit that will be produced on the conference weekend. And, you know, and that's why I say that the most important ministers at a Steubenville conference are not on the stage. It's you guys out there who are doing the work. We are grateful, humbled by your service, because without you doing what you're doing, we don't have jobs here doing what we're doing. So we love you guys, and we wish the best for you. I think there are a few more questions that came through, and I want to invite everyone at this time. If you have any questions that were not a part of this, a topic that wasn't mentioned yet, we already have a couple of those that we'll get to. We'll take time to talk about those. And if you have any other ideas for topics that you would like to see in future webinars, please feel free to enter that in at this time as well. So, Sarah, Kristi, do you see any questions that we need to address?
Yes, we received a question. Oh, go ahead.
No, go ahead, Sarah.
I have teens who have been to conferences and feel that they are missing out because they have not had some bad experience. at the conference are there speakers or times to build up students who are solid? And so, you know, that whole gamut that we're speaking to, teens who have had a rough past or different things like that versus teens who have just always been on the journey, who've been good kids. And so a couple things that we try to do and just really empowering our hosts to, again, address that wide spectrum of people that are there. And in the back of all the speakers' minds, just reminding them of that wide range of the audience of, you know, you'll have such a mixed bag of life experience in the audience and to keep that in mind as they're sharing. And I think among our speaking team, you know, there is a variety of witness from the stage as well. And then in terms of the programming, especially for, you know, kind of like you're asking to build up teens who are solid, we're offering something deeper for teens in our programming and our workshops and different things like that. We're really trying to look at it. What can we offer some of those teens who are great, solid, and on the journey, but are looking for something deeper? And so, for example, this coming summer, we're going to have a workshop called Life in the Holy Spirit, just greater depth on what it means to walk with the Holy Spirit, who the Holy Spirit is, and how they can pray with other people and things like that. So we're trying to keep that in the back of our mind as we come up with topics for those who are ready to go deeper. And then again, just in general, from the main stage, just emphasizing to the speakers to remember that wide range of experience in the room. So I don't know if Kristi or John, you have anything to add to that.
I mean, I'll add that I was a teen that had a similar experience. You know, I was a teen that was pretty, you know, good for the most part and hadn't done anything wrong and always wanted that testimony or that story. I think one thing you can do as a youth group leader and as a chaperone or, you know, group leader at the conference is have some of your chaperones or some of your, if you have young adults helping, like share stories with people who have not necessarily been the prodigal son story, but, or maybe the older brother story, you know, the story of the person who didn't necessarily have all these external, I would call them fleshy sins, but somebody that just, you know, was struggling in other ways. Unfortunately, I did have that time in my life where I did go off and become the prodigal son and then came back. And I saw that there was a part of me that just felt more loved because I had fallen more and he had loved me more. And that was just a misunderstanding of God and his love for me. So a lot of that is just being patient with them on the journey, but we also have to be teaching them along the way that that it's not about just those people that have a story. Everyone has a story, and helping them see that. But like Sarah said, we do make an intentional effort to tell our speakers to speak to that wide range of audience. You'll see it specifically in our men's and women's sessions. We've made a concerted effort over the last couple of years to not just be talking to, you know, because we have, for example, the women's session, we have girls there who are no longer virgins and may be sleeping with people more often than not. And then we have people there who have never kissed anybody or dated anyone. So speaking about chastity to that wide range of people, we focus a lot on virtue and about, we still touch on chastity and modesty and all of that, but really keeping a positive slant on it. So that would be one way in which we've done some of that. So I was just looking at the other guys.
Yeah, those are both, you know, both great, great comments to that concern. And you know, I think that's, you know, and part of this, you know, you can actually maybe talk to them about, you know, the difference between, you know, St. Paul and St. Timothy. You know, St. Paul, of course, had that radical conversion as he was traveling on the road to Damascus, who lived a life very apart from God, persecuted and brought about the murder of early Christians, right? Whereas St. Timothy grew up in the faith. You know, his aunt, his grandmother were, you know, friends of Paul's. He was always around faithful people. He never had this deep conversion. And yet the call that Paul gave to Timothy was no less dramatic and powerful in the life of Timothy as the call that Jesus Christ himself gave to Paul on the road to Damascus, which is, you know, give your life completely to God. You know, if you're looking at other people's stories and trying to base your faith on what other people have gone through, then you're comparing it to the wrong person. Measure your life against the standard of Christ and ask them to be the ones who radically go even deeper with the Lord. You know, and another thing is just to remind them that to whom much is given, much is expected. And to let them know that there's a I guess I don't want to get too in-depth in this because I can go on, but there's something called like cramp of grace. Like those who have not fallen in sin have not fallen into serious sin because God had been preserving them through grace and through protection to keep them from falling for a particular reason. And it's not about the radicalness of your conversion, but the depth of openness and response to that grace that's there. I mean, we'll never know the sins that God preserved us from. We were too focused on the sins we committed. But when we get to heaven, I guarantee you, the story that God will tell us is more about the sins that he kept us free from through grace that we never knew was preemptive mercy that was being poured out on us. And that might be a good topic to talk about during the year of mercy with these young people who feel like, oh, I didn't really do anything bad, but I need to have this fallen away. It's like, no. Preemptive mercy preserves you in purity. It preserves your integrity and your wholeness because God is probably, asking you to do something amazing. And so let them know that this is not a bad thing, but it's a very beautiful thing and that they need to rejoice in it and be able to celebrate that in their life and not be, I need a better testimony, Alrighty, we're getting a number of questions. Another one was, I'll make sure we don't skip over. Sister Mary Claire, you asked, how do we praise and worship the teens who stare at you and act as if they hate you when you ask them to enter into worship? Sister, my only response to that is, young people will not praise Jesus until they have a reason to praise him. I think worship is always a response to what God does first. And to try to focus kids into that posture who've not had that radical encounter with Christ is like trying to put the wrong peg in the square hole. It just doesn't work. Young people, when they're at a sporting event, they can jump up and scream and pump their fists, and it's a reaction to what they know. It's a response to what they see. And when they taste and see the goodness of the Lord, that desire to worship will be brought forth by the Holy Spirit. My only advice there is continue to model your joyful worship of the Lord. Let them stare at you because they're only staring because they don't know who you're worshiping yet. And as you help them to come to know Christ, their hunger for Christ and their desire to express their love for Christ will deepen and strengthen in their own lives. So it's a challenge because we're already there. We want everyone just to jump on board. But I think we've all had a story where we had to grow into our desire to praise God, and we just need to be patient with young people, especially those who don't know the Lord and don't really have a reason to praise him yet. But hopefully, if they have a good conference experience by Saturday night, after adoration, they won't be able to keep themselves from singing. So I don't know if you guys have anything you want to add to that, but go ahead.
I have anything to add. I was just going to do another question that came through. This question is, how do you suggest we identify where the kids are on their journey and what are good questions? My favorite way of doing this, and maybe just because I'm a very visual person, but it's also kind of, I don't know, I think it just works with everyone no matter where you are in your journey, is I ask them to take a moment, close their eyes, and think about if you and Jesus were in the room together, where is Jesus and where are you? Physically. And so ask them, think about your experience or your relationship with Jesus, or God, however you want to do it. Like, where is he and where are you? So, and then I give examples so they kind of know what I'm talking about. Like, are y'all, hand in hand? You have to choose your audience here, if you have a mature audience or not. Or are y'all, looking at the same book? Are y'all, sitting on his lap? Is he holding you? Are you crying on his shoulder? Is he way in the corner over there and you're way in the corner over here and y'all way separated? I ask everybody to think about that, and then I have everybody in the group share. Just where would you say you are with if you had you and Jesus in the room? So anyway, that's worked out really well, and it's really beautiful what some of the teens will share. And it really gives me a glimpse into where are they? I remember one time one girl shared that her and Jesus were just forehead, forehead to forehead, just gazing in each other's eyes, and silent. And I was like, that is just a really cool visual, I've had other teens that are very honest, and they say, we're like my back is to him and I'm looking at the wall. Or I'm trying to get Jesus' attention, but he's over there doing something else. So you really, it taps into that. So it's a good way to ask that question to identify where they are on the spiritual journey without, I don't know, it's just a creative way to do that. So that's a suggestion that I have for that question.
Sherry, you have anything you want to add?
Just a question that popped into my mind when I read your question was, having them pick a word to describe how they view God might be helpful to help them know where they are just in their vision of who God is in their life. It might be positive or it might be negative. That might be another helpful question to help identify how they see God and therefore will affect the type of relationship they have with him. And then also just, you know, in terms of prayer, like, you know, some of them might not even really know what it means to have a prayer time, but like, how often do you think of God, or how often do you talk to him, you know? And some might say, well, I never talk to him, or some could say, you know, well, throughout my day, you know, I'll talk to him when things are going on, you know? And so those are two other simple questions that could be helpful to help identify.
Yeah, and in that document that I sent you guys a link for, there's some general questions, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, how important is God or your relationship with Jesus to you? How often do you pray? Who do you pray for? What does prayer mean to you? And these are the kind of questions, and this is why, once again, especially if you want to accompany kids on a profound spiritual journey, you need to take the time to get to know them, to build that relationship, to hear their story. You know, when it comes to small group leading, you know, I always tell people to lead small groups, you got two ears and one mouth. Use them in that proportion. You know, don't be speaking more than you're listening. You should be listening a lot more than you're talking as the leader. And so to ask the right questions, you know, you don't want to answer the yes or no, but ask those kind of questions that get them thinking. And you might even, you know, for young people who are unfamiliar with, you know, being vulnerable or opening up, you might even ask them to write the questions down. You know, and young people will be, you know, they go online to these there's certain websites where you can type in what you're struggling with and you can do it anonymously. And they have no problem going to some of these sites and just unpacking their garbage. But, you know, as soon as they feel like they might be found out, the walls can come up. But these questions are just little probing questions that get them thinking. Because they might not have ever been asked to consider, what is your relationship with God like? They might have to come to the conclusion that I don't really have a relationship with God. They might come to the conclusion, I don't know what a relationship is. You know what I mean? But if we ask the right questions and we give them a place where you go, hey, it doesn't matter how you answer. We're here to help you discover more about yourself and how on that journey, then they're going to open up. And so there's a lot of good questions in that document that I sent you. And what Kristi said is give them a little bit of a guided kind of meditation that's not too heavy to think about. Like Sarah said, you know, just asking those great, the right kind of questions that help them think, not with the rational part, but more of that feeling side. Like, where are they? Those are good because they're not really in touch with their hearts in a lot of ways. So all great suggestions, and the document has that in that kind of stuff as well.
Great. A couple of other questions have come up. One was, I'll just do two that we can go through real quick. We have small books where they can take notes at the conference, and the answer is no, we don't. So if you have people, you know, if you want to encourage them to bring a journal, if they want to take notes, but we do not provide like a booklet or anything to take notes in. So that's something that if you feel like that would be valuable, let them know about that ahead of time. And then another question was, do you suggest letting kids see all the small group questions or keeping the questions just to the adults? My recommendation is keeping them just to the adult leaders, because I think, and I don't remember, John, are we doing a small group webinar on small groups?
We're going to do a whole webinar that's going to have a lot about the small group process in it. So, yeah, we're going to go in much, much more depth in one. It's either going to be in April or May. So stay tuned. You know, we'll be sending out the email blast, and you'll get the information of the sign-up link.
So the short answer to that question is that I wouldn't recommend giving it to the teens, because as a small group leader, you're not going to necessarily ask all the questions that are on the sheet. You're going to think through what's going to be best for this group. You're going to come up with questions on the fly because the Holy Spirit is going to inspire you to ask a certain question. you're going to reword the questions specific for the group and such. So as a good small group leader, you're kind of always thinking of like, okay, how can I do this question best for this group? And so it gives you the freedom to do that if you don't give them the list of questions ahead of time. So my recommendation is not to do that. Sarah, did you want to answer some of these other ones? Or?
Yeah, so there's a question of, is there a way we can know which breakout would be specific? Wait, I'm sorry. Is there a way we can know which breakout would be for specific spiritual levels as leaders so we can help the teams choose correctly? And so something that we do is we create a short video of the schedule and just briefly going over the flow as well as some of the content for the talks as well as the workshops. And so we're actually going to send that link out to you so you can watch that video, and it'll give just a brief blurb to help you know which ones might be a little bit more depth versus not. And I can tell you right now what the topics are if you're curious. So as I mentioned, the life and the Holy Spirit. We're doing another one titled Love, Same-Sex Attraction. Love and Same-Sex Attraction. We're doing one on Thirsting for Truth, which is going to talk about different aspects of the faith, almost like apologetics, but just really just teaching them about different elements of the Catholic faith. And then one on the Christian life, just about discernment, hearing God's voice, and how to use their talents and gifts for God and His glory. So those are the four workshop titles for this year, but there's more detail about them in the videos that they'll send you the link there on the chat.
And if you've never been to a conference before, how that works is there's two workshops at one time. So there's two rounds of workshops, and there's two options during each round. So of those four, they'll get to hear two of them. And choose two of them. But again, you can hear, you know, more information on that video. I think John just sent out that link. So it's a YouTube video, and you'll see it just, we go through the entire conference schedule. So if you are unfamiliar with what we do, that's a good one for you to check out. There's another question here. John, I wondered if you could answer this. It says, how do you suggest dividing small groups other than male and female?
That's a really great question, and I want to talk about it. You know, Carol, you also asked the question, how do we suggest, you know, what are some good questions? I gave you some good questions. I just want to touch upon the first part, like, how do you identify where kids are on their journey? You know, I mean, I think there's a couple of levels that we find young people in our youth groups at. Number one is pre-evangelization. These are young people who've never really had a chance to respond to the question, do you want to make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life? And that question usually spawns out of a personal encounter with Christ. So it's hard to commit your woman if you don't know. You like try to get, you know, do a shotgun wedding with a woman that you just met or a man you just met. It just doesn't work. And so for us to understand, there's some kids who need to have that encounter. So that's one level. Then there's people who are in evangelization. They're seeking God, but maybe they're not quite there, but you're evangelizing them. They're part of your youth group. And the ultimate goal of evangelization is to get them to the point where they understand what it means to give their lives to Christ, and they make a personal and public proclamation that I've made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life. We do this in the context of youth group because this is the community that's going to support your decision. This is the community that's going to stand by you to help you live out that commitment. And so you might have a lot of young people that maybe they've never had that radical encounter. And maybe they've been encountering God in the sacraments, we all have, yet they haven't had the grace activated so that they can firmly make that decision to make Jesus Christ the Lord of their lives. And then you're going to have other young people who they've already had that encounter. They are, they've made Jesus Christ the Lord of their life, but they really haven't adapted that to an overall comprehensive view of themselves. Like there might be areas of their life that are still in sin. They might still be struggling with different temptations and doubts. And so, you know, not that those are not a normal part of ongoing conversion, but, you know, they've had this encounter, they've accepted Christ, but they haven't conformed their life to the gospel yet. So you have a lot of kids who've been evangelized but need to learn about conforming their lives to Christ. And that has to do with teaching them how to pray, how to go to confession, how to, you know, what Christian living looks like. Because a lot of them, you know, they have this wonderful mountaintop experience, but they need to sink those roots deeper. And then you have, maybe you have a group of kids in your youth group that are like, I know what I know, and I'm ready to go with the Lord. They may still struggle occasionally with sin, but they've broken from all the habitual sin in their lives. They've made Christ the Lord over everything. They're actively praying. They're seeking Christ in the sacraments beyond Sunday. They're witnessing to their faith. They've reached the level where they're really living as true disciples of Christ. And those are four kind of distinguishing points on youth conversion that you can look at. And it's always good to know that they may go back and forth. You know, a kid who might have a strong relationship with God, they might go through a divorce or a situation in their life that causes them to slide back and kind of things fall apart for a while. And so it's very fluid, and you don't certainly don't want to put a kid in a box and say, well, you're this, and that's all you'll ever be. You want to get, because knowing where they're at is about making sure you're engaging them with the message where they're at, not to label them or to keep them confined, but to really know how you can best serve them where they're at on their spiritual journey. These questions that I say, a lot of them will help reveal that. If young people can't tell you if they've made Jesus Christ the Lord of their life, then that's a pretty good indication they have. You know what I mean? Like, it really is a decision that you remember. And so as you break up your youth group, there's two schools of thought. Number one, guys and girls for sure, and for a number of reasons, they need to be in separate groups. The issues that guys want to talk about, they'll talk about honestly with other guys, but they may not talk about them in front of women and vice versa. It's just a standard rule. Most people who've been doing youth ministry know this rule. Where it gets more tricky is, do you take the younger kids who are all younger in their spiritual journey, put them in small groups, and then take the kids who might be more advanced and put them so that they can talk about more advanced issues? Because then you can focus on conversations that help them meet them where they are, and same with the kids who may be younger in the faith. There's another school of thought that says, hey, put some of these older kids in there to work with the younger kids to bring them up. You know, they can witness, they can share, they can role model, they can kind of be big brothers and sisters in the Lord. I personally think there's other opportunities for that kind of mentoring to happen in a youth group environment, and would recommend, although you're very free to disagree with me, of keeping your more advanced together and your younger, because really, the community you can create amongst these guys coming up, you know, and sharing this faith and engaging them as a group and talking about those issues can be very key. And it would be very different than how you would talk and lead a small group of young people who have maybe made Jesus Christ the Lord of their life and are more advanced in their faith. Now, there's definitely a need to get these groups mixing on other levels within different environments within youth ministry. But I think because of the spiritual nature and the small windows of time that we have on conferences to make things happen, you'd be better serving kids where they're at and leading them where they're at, rather than trying to create, these boundaries or these different levels, I should say. And that's, I throw that out only as an opinion, and I know some people might disagree, and that's fine. It's just my personal. So I hope that helps. Real quick, a future talk about adoration. Yes, one of our webinars coming up will specifically deal with the unique and powerful spiritual manifestations that you see at a Steubenville conference and how to pastor them, including being slain in the spirit, crying, laughter, and really what should be the response, because I think that's absolutely essential for us to make sure that experience is the best for the young people. So that will definitely be a topic that we're going to be discussing in one of our future. Somebody asked me to repeat my statement about being preserved from sin. And this is a book that I read, and it was really profound, and talking about the mercy of God, not just coming to us after we sin, but because mercy is God's unmerited favor, his unmerited grace, it is possible for God to pour mercy out on us before we have the opportunity to sin in order to preserve us from that sin. It's not a radical, crazy thought. It's a realistic and honest spiritual movement that God chooses. He preserved a lot of saints in grace. And those saints that were preserved in grace, I think of someone like Maximilian Kolbe, who as a young child was blessed, visited by the Virgin Mary and offered either a martyr's crown or a crown of glory, and he wanted them both. He said, I'll take them both. You know, we see what happened in his life. Or you have someone like St. John Paul the Great, who his mother died when he was young, and right after his mother died, his only sibling died, and he came home when he was 20 and found his father dead on the floor. All these tragedies happened to him, and yet he had such a profound faith. and you have stories of St. Augustine, who was living in sin, and then you have St. Teresa of Lisieux as a little child, you know, all these different saints come from all over the place, and God meets us where we are, and I really believe that some of the saints, and he still does this today, as he sends his mercy, it precedes us. We haven't earned it, we don't deserve it, but it precedes us because it's his good pleasure to keep some people from falling in sin because of the particular vocation or life that they're calling them to. So, what else, guys?
John, maybe here's a question that we could brainstorm. But as this person says, I think this is a common question. I have about 15 kids attending. I'm not sure if one of my chaperones has, quote, confirmed their life to the gospel, and I'm not sure if they're prepared to lead a small group. So how do I handle that? So when you have a small group, when you have the chaperones that are coming that maybe aren't walking in their faith the way that you would want them to be in order to lead a small group, or maybe just don't feel equipped to lead a small group. John, what would you say to that one?
Sure. In the last youth ministry job I had, I showed up at this parish where, you know, there's two things that you can do. You can start a youth group and you can get the people that God has sent you that are awesome, or you can work with the people that God sends you who are just who they are. And part of what I see is the responsibility of the group leaders to work with the adults that they're bringing. I always said to them as we started this youth ministry process, and they said, I want to come on, I want to help with youth group. And I started asking them about their faith and yes, okay, I'm not doing this, or yes, I'm doing this. And I wanted to say, you know, what I said to them is, if you want to be effective with working with young people, you know, you need to be letting that be the overflow of what God is doing in your life. So you don't have to be perfect, but you have to be letting God work in your life every day. And so maybe you have a chaperone, and this is even a more unique situation, because maybe they're only going to be helping you for this weekend. Maybe they're not an ongoing core team member. Maybe they are. But if they're only helping for that weekend, then you just really need to sit down with them and say, we're going to pair you up. You know, here's one of the ideas. Pair them up with one of your teens that may be more advanced in their faith, who can kind of help co-lead the small group. Because if this guy can't witness to the faith, you know, then maybe one of the teens could help out doing that. But the adult chaperone, if he's being authentic and letting his heart is open to God and God is working to him, when he speaks and when he leads, God will use that. God doesn't call the equipped. He equips those he calls. And so he will use the chaperone. And I think, you know, one of the things I was very clear with is, if you are in mortal sin, though, you need to go to confession. And if you will not, you don't have to be perfect, but if you don't see the need for yourself to rid your life of those things that separate you from God, then we're not going to be able to lead kids anywhere, because we can't lead them unless we're heading them there ourselves. Now, once again, you know, do you want to sit down and ask this volunteer if, you know, 20 questions about their lifestyle? No, I think you need to just say, look, you know, we would really hope that the way we're living our life is a life that's in pursuit of God. And I'll tell you what, those group leaders and chaperones that I brought to conferences with me had just a profound conversion as the teens there. So I think maybe what you could do is to be praying that the chaperone really jumps into this process and has his own conversion as well. If they don't feel they're prepared to lead a small group, you can help them get prepared. We're going to do this whole webinar where we're going to be more expanding on some more basic technical and advanced ways of leading a small group that have proven time and time again to be helpful. So yeah, I would recommend that you get them on that with us and have them be a part of that, because, you know, it will really help them know what their role is at the conference. So I hope that helps. I mean, I know that we don't want to take a risk. If somebody has like an axe to grind with God and doesn't believe the gospel and is, you know, speaking against teachings of the church, they're going to undermine your ability to reach these kids. So you can't have someone on your team like that. But if they're of goodwill and seeking the Lord, maybe they're not completely the most perfect disciple. If they're trying and they can be authentic with the teens and love them and be open to the experience with the teens, I believe that they can be effective on the conference weekend.
Another question that came up was, do we have any unique and fun ideas for community builders on the road trip, like things you can do on the road trip? Well, first I'll say there's lots and lots and lots of good books and websites out there that have great icebreakers and fun, you know, ideas for that. So if you do just quick search on that, I think you'll find some pretty solid things. Maybe this is something we can add on to another webinar, John, just like a few ideas that are a little bit more tried and true in the future. But there's lots and lots of resources out there in regards to ideas you can do for those types of things. I know we have a book here in the office called Icebreakers, Volume 1 and Volume 2 or something like that. So, again, there's lots of good stuff out there in regards to that.
Yep. All right. Okay. Is it best to keep close friends together in a small group or separate them? Yeah. And Cheryl, you also had the other question. We'll get to both of them. I think it really just is your personal preference. I don't know if it's better because, like, I've seen some guys, if it's the kind of relationship where it's iron sharpens iron, and these guys already have it in their relationship that they help each other get closer to God, then I would say keep them together. If they're like gasoline in the match, and when you put together, you get this explosive combination of distraction and noise and goofiness, and, you know, sometimes you just have those kind of personalities between friends, then I would separate them. If they can't work to help you, you know, if your mission is to develop deeper community, to create an environment of trust, and sometimes these relationships can work against that. But if they're good together, you know, and they really have, they hold one another accountable, and they've already been on a spiritual journey, there's really not a problem with that, in my view. And once again, you need to know your teams well enough to make that judgment, you know, to the best of your ability. We like to mix it up. Like, if you have three people who say they want to be together, or four people, like, hey, we all want to be a small group, we would usually say at that point, well, we'll put two of you in this group, two of you, so no one's alone, yet you don't create a clique. You know, two friends together, okay, once you put four people who are kind of clicky, that could undermine a small group as well. You don't want three people sitting over there saying, well, these four people over here are having this great conversation, we're left out, you know. You really want it to be more creative with an even playing field to the best of your ability. And then you ask, I have a young man who admits he has no belief, doesn't even know if he believes in God. He attends youth group weekly. How and where do I begin to introduce Jesus to him? First thing, just affirm him. Why would somebody who doesn't believe in God keep coming to youth group? And I think that's also maybe an affirmation of what you're doing. He may not believe that there's a God or be convinced totally, but there's something about what you're doing that's drawing this young man in. And that's a beautiful thing. You're on the cutting edge of where I think youth ministry should be, not just preaching to the converted, but working with young people who are struggling, that those who feel they have no faith would feel they are welcome and belong. And I would say that's where you start. Sometimes the greatest obstacle to people's hearts is their head. You know, other times the greatest obstacle for them to be able to say, I believe in God up here, is something happened in their hearts. You know, there's a lot of people who know Christ as a concept, as an idea that they really want to cling to, but they, you know, the journey from the head to the heart has not happened. Other people, their hearts are aching for the Lord, but there's something in their mind, I just can't believe that. That seems too ridiculous. That needs to be overcome. But whatever you do, whenever you're in this situation, Cheryl, when you're witnessing the gospel to them, and just being Jesus, all right? That's the way you're going to help help him overcome whatever obstacle is inside. And, you know, I would also, you know, just in that, help him to understand what is his obstacle. You know, what makes it hard for him to believe? Because if he knows what it is and you know what it is, then you can both, like, be praying for it, you know? And, you know, belief is something that we have to be able to willingly step into, but if we're chained or restricted, he may not feel free to even enter into that, so... I hope that helps. You guys have anything you want to add to that?
I think so. There was one other question that I think we can answer. It says, in the past, about 3 years ago, you all had a four-week session prep for youth ministers to gather and go over with teens. Will you be sending anything like this to us this year?
Yeah, I think if you're referring to the series of videos that I created, where it was like how to do that stuff, You know, we are going to have those available, but we're updating them. So, yeah, we're going to have videos on our website. We need to sign off here in 4 minutes. I just looked at the clock. So I want to be faithful to let everyone get back, including Sarah. And I know Kristi wants to get home to her baby and her husband, hubby. So, you know, and I need to get home to my wife and kids, too. So what I would recommend is just keep looking at Steubenville Fuel. We have a section, and this has been a work in progress. We launched this fall, and we've been launching it kind of in waves. And the next wave we're really going to be tackling is creating resources for you guys. Like I said, the most important ministry that happens at a student conference is brought about by people like yourselves. And so we want to walk with you as youth ministers before the conference, during the conference, and after the conference. So there will be... we will you talk about that. I saw your notes. You're good. there will be stuff for you guys up on the Fuel site, stuff that you can download. This link that I just sent you for the small group questions, I'll transform that into a PDF and put that up there, downloadable from the group leaders and youth ministers and chaperones site. So, and it's going to be stuff like Bible studies that we're going to be preparing to get kids ready for the conference that will be ready in April. So you can have a couple sessions in April, maybe a couple in May, to get ready with your teens as well as getting your core team ready. Last year we had this Fruits of the Holy Spirit kind of thing after the conference. We're going to do more stuff like that. Bible studies. We did our At Via Disciple Engagement, where we have 30 videos for young people to watch to learn how to become better disciples. We're going to create more resources like that and give them to you to use with them. We just have uploaded the Judgmental Moose and Ask Jay. You're wondering what's Judgmental Moose and Ask Jay. Just go to Steubenville Field. You'll find it there in the next couple of days. It's great stuff for you to look at. And we're going to be creating a webinar page where you're going to be able to find all these webinars, and as well as links to sign up for future webinars. Because somebody asked about, you know, when are the future dates. We'll have those ready for you in the next email, so you can be marking your calendar well in advance. So be looking for an email in the next week or so, which will kind of nail this down for you then. So before we wrap up and close with a prayer, I wanted to give Sarah an opportunity to talk about what I think is one of the best things that we do, and both Kristi have made it just an amazing program. So take it away, Sarah.
Okay, so before all of our youth conferences, we have a program called Franciscan Lead, if you haven't heard about it. It's a week-long discipleship leadership week for teens in your youth group that are ready to take that next step deeper. And it kind of ties into a lot of the things we shared about on this webinar. We first focus on their relationship with Christ and bringing them deeper into prayer, and then giving them tools to be leaders in their youth group. We teach them how to share witness. We teach them about servant leadership and humility. And on Friday, at the end of the lead week, they would rejoin your youth group coming for the conference weekend. And we really encourage them to serve and just be present to all of those coming, to share their witness, to serve you as a group leader in any way, possibly co-lead a small group if that's a desire that you have for them. So it's a beautiful opportunity for them to grow deeper in faith, but also for you and your youth group. So there's a lot of information on our website. So if you go to our website, there's a tab at the top, lead, that you can click on. It's an online application process, and so there's a lot of details on the website as well. And if you have any questions, you can email us at franciscanlead@franciscan.edu.
All right.
Yeah,
thank you all.
1 minute or less.
What's that?
I said, there you have it, in 1 minute or less.
Thank you, Sarah. And thank you all for being a part of this. Once again, you'll find this webinar posted on our Steubenville Field site under the group leader section in a few days. In the meantime, go and check out all the resources we have for you there. There's going to be more stuff for group leaders coming up in the next month or so. Like I said, prep resources for your teens, for you, for your core team, for your for everybody. And we're really excited about being able to bring those to you. We're excited about being able to serve you this summer at one of our conferences. Like we said, you guys are amazing. You're why we do what we do, and a big part of that. We do it with great joy because, you know, it's our honor and our privilege to be able to serve you in this way. So until next time, if you have any other questions, you know, my email address is was sent out with all of the invitations to the webinar. So if you have any other questions or ideas or comments or concerns that you didn't get to express on this that you want to send to me, especially ideas for resources or future webinars, feel free to shoot me an email. We're really busy in the office this time, as you can imagine, but I will take the time as soon as I have a free moment to answer your emails in any way possible. And yeah, once again, thank you. Sarah, would you mind closing us in a prayer?
Sure. Yeah,
put you on the spot.
Holy Spirit, amen. Lord God, we just ask you to pour your Holy Spirit upon us and every single youth that will be coming to our conferences this summer. I pray that you may already be preparing their hearts for the work that you want to do in them that weekend. I pray special blessings upon all of our group leaders and chaperones, that you would bless them abundantly and give them the graces they need to serve you. And I pray that we may glorify you, Lord, in everything that we do. Amen.
Amen. All right, everybody. Have a blessed week. Have a blessed Lent. We'll see you this summer.